Moment. So. Maybe in a slightly unusual setup on compact manifolds. So I'd like to consider the following initial value problem. I dtu plus Laplacian of u is equal to, let's say, 0. And u at time 0 is equal to a given function phi. And now let's say this is the Laplace-Beltrami operator on a compact manifold M. Compact, smooth Riemannian manifold without boundary. Okay, so so let's start with this linear problem first. And okay, so how can we write down the solution to this? So here, of course, phi is some given function on the manifold from the manifold M to the complex numbers, and it will have some maybe smooth or in some Sobolev spaces, or I will specify this. But first of all, let's try to write down a formula for the solution to this problem. And to fix notation. So the spectrum of the Laplace operators is discrete, and I would like to write it as spectrum of minus Laplace is the eigenvalues. I would like to denote them by lambda j squared, the increasing sequence going to infinity. And let's say, okay, so then I would like to decompose L2 of m as the orthogonal decomposition into eigenspaces Ek, where now Ek is the eigenspace corresponding to the eigenvalue lambda k squared, minus lambda k squared. So it's an orthogonal decomposition. And then I would like to, introduce the projections Hk from projection L2 the orthogonal projection onto Ek. Okay, so this is all very basic, and now let's continue with some basic examples. So first example is, say M is the free sphere with the canonical metric. Okay, so then the eigenvalues can be computed, and this is and lambda n squared is then it depends on the dimension. So as a dimension 3, then it's lambda squared plus n squared plus 2n. And eigenspace En is the span of the spherical harmonics. Degree n. Okay, and the dimension is, this formula also depends on the dimension, but I think it should be precisely n squared. Okay, it's of order n squared in any case. Okay, so this is one instance, and another interesting example in for us will be the three torus with a flat matrix. So let's say. And now I can. Okay, now the spectrum of minus Laplace is, so I will drop the G from now, and so the spectrum will be is. Are all numbers n which can be written as the sum of three squares. So where kj is natural numbers or zero. And I'd like to order them. So let's write lambda zero squared less than lambda one squared and so on. As above. So now what's the eigenspace? So that's, I can explicitly write this down. It's the sum over all k in Z3 such that n is equal to mod k squared e to the I k dot x ck with some sequence for some ck's in. Okay, so what is the dimension of the eigenspace in this case? Well, that's more complicated, right? So it is the number of all, I can write it as the number of all points on the two-sphere with radius root n. All the lattice points on that sphere. Okay, and now, so what's this number? Well, it's difficult to make this more precise, but it's O of n to the 1/2 plus epsilon as n tends to infinity. Okay, this. There are classical results for computing the asymptotics of this. And these numbers, I mean, depending on the dimension. So if the dimension is high enough, then there's a precise asymptotic for it. If the dimensions are lower, then there are some log losses. Sometimes these numbers can be slightly improved. At this point, I don't want to go into details here, but the point I want to make is this is actually this number, and it is the okay. So this is done with the Hardy-Littlewood circle method. Asymptotics and okay. So I think we might come back to that later. So okay, now I would like to study this initial value problem. So what I did is we discussed two examples of compact manifolds, wrote down the spectrum and the eigenfunction, essentially. So now what do we do with this? For function phi in L2, now I can write phi as the sum over n hn phi. And So the solution of the initial value problem can be written down in terms of this spectral information, in terms of the spectral information. Oh, okay, so now I have to decide. I apologize to the person who is next. Okay, so the solution U of t and x can be written as sum n e to the minus I t lambda n squared h n phi of x. And this I would like to denote as e to the I t delta phi. Okay, so I can write this down. It makes sense in L2. There's L2. It converges in L2. And now let us summarize some properties. Well, this is a this defines a group of unitary operators. In Sobolev spaces HS, which I haven't defined yet, so I should do this. Okay, so here HS is the Sobolev space, and I would like to define it spectrally, so the space of all final. Okay, so let's say S positive, then I say take all final two such that the corresponding the following norm is finite. So I take the sum over all n, lambda n to the 2s times h n phi in L2 squared, square root of this. This number is finite. And say for S negative, it's just the dual. Okay. Maybe one remark here. So we will frequently compute or doing we will be doing estimates in these spaces, but usually I would like to use slightly different but equivalent norm. Sum over all dyadic numbers n. N to the 2s pn. And here I should explain what pn is. So let's do it here. Pn is a projection on all the eigenspaces of eigenvalues which are size n. So formally I can write it as sum of all hn, such that n is less or equal to lambda n less than 2n. And dyadic, I mean, to be complete, I should say pn is just h, p0 is h0. Okay? And dyadic, if I write this, I will drop the dyadic in the following talk. So if n is 0, it's clear what it means, but then I add up all numbers of the of the form 2 to the n for n an integer. Okay, and I will drop this word dyadic and just wrote n greater or equal to 0 to indicate this. Actually, I should make sure that this is 1 if I put like n equals 0. Okay, this is what it means. Same here. So the second property I would like to write down is that for given initial data in HS, the map T goes to e to the I T delta. Oops. This map is continuous from the real line into the Sobolev space HS. So this is all I want to say about the linear, the initial value problem. And maybe one example, a trivial one. Again, if the manifold is just the torus, then of course I could have computed this as a Fourier series, and it looks as follows. I take all three tuples of integers k e to the I t mod k squared plus x dot k, and multiply this with the Fourier coefficient of the k's Fourier coefficient of phi. Okay, in particular, I wanted to write this down explicitly because it shows that if I plug in t plus 2 pi here, I mean, it's, you see from here it's periodic in time, right? So this is e to the I t plus 2 pi delta is equal to e to the I t delta. Okay, so now let's compare it with this situation on RD. You can also, of course, consider the Schrödinger equation on RD. So in that case, so in digression, e to the i t delta, some integrable function phi, is given as 1 over 4 pi I t to the d over 2, integral over d e to the minus I x minus y squared divided by 4t times phi of y dy. And now since phi is integrable, so in this case, it is obvious that if I take the soup in x, the absolute value of this quantity, this is bounded by, so one over four pi t to the d over two. In particular, it decays as t goes to infinity. So this is a dispersive, the dispersive estimate. So it means that the solution spreads out as time goes to infinity. And also, it's still. Oh yeah, thank you. So maybe not. So let me put L1 here. Okay, my point is the following. Also on RD, it's a group of unitary, we define a group of unitary operators on Sobolev spaces HS, particularly on L2. So what it means is that the L2 mass stays constant in time, but it disperses, but the solution disperses, spreads out. And this is different in the case of a compact manifold because nothing can go to infinity. And so now the question, somehow very general question now, is what means dispersion then if you consider the compact manifold? And that is partly what my talk is about. We will see. Next, I would like to present some analogs of dispersive estimates, which are by now classical. The first example of an estimate which has some kind of a dispersive character goes back, which I would like to mention, is goes back to Bogen, and this is in the context of tori on TD, always with flat metric. So there's the following estimate: e to the it delta phi in LP. Yeah, okay, so let's write I cos maybe 0, 1 times t to the d. So this is for the time, and this is for space variables, and this is bounded by some constant times. Oh, okay, now I have to put a projection, projector pi pn here, and then there's a universal constant times the dependence on n, which is some power of n, which I don't want to specify now. It's some exponent sigma, which depends on d and p, times pn phi in L2. exactly. Yes. So, and this now you should, okay, so first let me complete. Exactly. The truth is, it doesn't matter. So you can put any compact time interval here. So I just made a choice now. Any compact time interval is fine here. And this holds if if P is big enough. Again, depending on the dimension, okay? And it's, it has been verified for certain P. It has been, these estimates have been extended. Now there's this, one knows quite a lot about these estimates, but I don't want to be very specific here. I just wanted to say that this, okay, so this, of course, if I write it abstractly like this, it's trivial, right? Because you can just use the Sobolev embedding with respect to the spatial variables, go from LP to L2, this costs the number of derivatives, and then you use the fact that it's an isometry in L2. Okay? So for some high numbers, big number sigma, it's trivial. The point here is that this number, sigma, this one, is below that number I just described. So it's below the number you would get from the Sobolev embedding. And it's actually a scale invariant. It's a number such that this estimate becomes scale invariant if you rescale space and time and ignore the fact that you can't really rescale, that you rescale your period. Okay, so, but we will be much more specific later. This is just the first example of an estimate which I, okay, so this means that I somehow, on average, I have higher LP norms. I can control higher LP norms in a non-trivial way, which means that there is some kind of dispersion going on. Okay, so then there is a much more general estimate by Birk, Gerard, and Zvetkov. From 2004, and this estimate is on the general compact manifold U in should be consistent E to the I T delta phi in LP in time on any compact time interval. So let me again choose 0, 1. With values in LQ on M, this is bounded by the H1 over P norm on M, and now 2 over P plus D over Q equal to D over 2, and P should be bigger than, we don't want to D to be 2 if the dimension, sorry, P to be 2 if the dimension is 2. Okay, so this, and now, okay, I forgot one thing, so sorry. So this is an analog of the classical Strichert estimate, which is a conclusion from the dispersive estimate, which my intention was to mention it right here, which I forgot to do. So let me go back. And so from this bound, one can use the Tiki Star argument and the Hardy Littlewood Sobolev lemma to conclude to conclude Strichert's estimate. And that is exactly, looks very similar to what I've written below, LP in time, actually on the full timeline, Q. This is bounded by some constant times phi in L2. And here again, we have the same condition. So let me call this star. Okay, these pairs satisfying this are called Schrödinger admissible pairs. And okay, then this is an easy consequence of the dispersive estimate. Now, the dispersive estimate fails in our case, in the case of uncompact manifolds, because necessarily so for example on the torus you easily see it because it's 2 pi periodic, so you can't have this bound. So despite this, it is possible to prove on a general compact manifold on compact time intervals to prove the analog of this estimate, but replacing L2 by some H S norm, so there's a certain loss of derivatives. And this loss of derivatives now, okay, so the little computation shows that this loss of derivatives is still better than what you would get by applying the same strategy as I described earlier. So if you apply the Sobolev embedding here, you would end up with, I think, 2 over P, but it's worse. Actually, this one is much better than this estimate. Okay, but this one is very interesting because it's general, so it's somehow the worst case estimate. Okay, so and also the proof is very interesting. So maybe I should describe it briefly. So what is done here is in this work of Birkscher and Svetkov is they decompose the compact time interval into, so first of all, by Littlewood-Paley theory, you can replace this by a dyadic. It suffices to look at dyadic, functions which are frequency localized on dyadic annuli. So if once you did that, you can replace, you can decompose this compact interval into lambda intervals of size 1 over lambda, where lambda is the size of all the frequencies in the annulus. So, and then on these short time intervals, the dispersive bound holds true. This one. So then on this compact, on this sub intervals, you get the loss, the estimate without loss. And then, then you have, by this decomposition, there's a certain loss coming from the decomposition, and this is exactly 1 over p. Okay, so. So this is the proof in short, and okay, this is not scale invariant. So in particular, later I'm interested in critical problems. So this estimate itself is not helpful in some sense because to attack such problems because there's this loss. Okay, but it's a robust estimate. I mean, this one is scale invariant, but it holds only on tori. And for high p. So. Okay, so okay, maybe one third remark in this context is that there's a certain improvement of this on spheres. So if m is a sphere, one can improve this a little bit. So I just write improvement. On spheres, but it's still, and this is again the same paper, and this is still not scale invariant, but optimal on spheres. Okay, so now let's move on to a nonlinear problem. famous to study the Cauchy problem. Of a nonlinear Schrödinger equation in the scale invariant. So maybe scale invariant, I mean, I will explain what it means, and it's not quite precise, this terminology. So let's be specific. I would like to focus on the following. I dtu plus Laplace and q is equal to, okay, let's say plus or minus mod u to the fourth power times u, and at time zero, again, we give this initial datum phi in some Sobolev space. And this Sobolev space is now H1. And say we are on a compact three-dimensional manifold. And the questions I would like to address, first of all, the question of local well-posedness. So by this, I mean existence, I mean as usual existence, and some kind of uniqueness of solutions, and continuous dependence on the initial data phi, and okay, so let's say if I start with smooth initial data, my solution should also be smooth. Okay, so then second question. Global. Typical question would be, can I find for any initial data phi in H1, can I find a global in time solution to this problem? Okay, and what I would like to do is I would like to show you how to prove local well-posedness, and then also give an let's say part of the answer to question number two, namely I will prove that this problem is globally well-posed if the initial data is small enough. Of course, that is much easier, and I will also mention then how this can be extended to arbitrary large initial data, at least in the defocusing case. Okay. And okay, next I will explain how the answer to question number one implies question number two, at least for small initial data. And because I mean this makes this specific problem very interesting, and I will comment on that later. So first of all, there are conservation laws. So there's an energy. So let's suppose now U is a nice solution to the problem. And then it's easy to compute that 1/2 integral grad U squared plus or minus 1/6 U to the power 6 dx. That this is constant in time, so this is E equal to E to phi, E of phi. Not necessarily. Yes, exactly. Okay, so that's a okay. So maybe that's a good. Okay, so this is a very important difference. Let me talk about this difference maybe briefly. So of course, so in, if you have so in this case we you don't, unlike the case of the heat equation, there's no gain of regularity, or so there's no so solution, typical solutions will oscillate, will be highly oscillatory, and it is a unitary group. Right, so that's very, it's very different in some sense. And okay, so that's one reason maybe why it's a bit more involved to prove a local bipartite. And okay, so but what we have is, on the other hand, we have conservation of energy. Okay, and you immediately see, so this is a very useful quantity, at least if there's a plus sign. And also, if the solutions are small enough, it is even useful if there's a minus sign, because then this is 6th power, this is 2nd power, so you can play with it and get good bounds for small data from here. So then there's the mass conservation. And this is just the L2 norm, essentially. So of course, I plug in T and X, and I integrate out integrate over X, right? The spatial variable. So this quantity depends on T, but in fact it doesn't. It's only, it is determined by the initial data.
Then 1/2,
yes, that's 1/2. In the defocusing case, it's called a, so the case of the plus sign is called the defocusing case. Of course, okay, maybe I should quickly write it down. So u of s time t in H1, then this is bounded above by obviously by m u of t plus e of u of t. Now, since this is a constant in time, so this is like e of phi, this is here m of phi. So now let's look at these quantities. So this is like the H1, this is the gradient u squared, in a gradient of u in L2 squared, plus the L6 norm to the power 6. Now, by the Sobolev, and this is just the L2 norm, so by the Sobolev embedding in 3 dimensions, this is bounded by some function of the norm of phi in H1. Okay, so here this is the Sobolev embedding in 3D, which is the L6 norm is bounded by the H1. Okay, great. So if this means that if we can solve question one, we can solve question two, at least if the time of existence is given by the H1 norm of the initial data, which will be the case if the initial data is small enough. Okay. So in the minus case, similar. If the initial data is small, I don't want to go into details here. It's an easy argument. So then, okay, now we are motivated to solve this question number one, the local well positiveness. But now let's. Now what's the? Why is it difficult? Okay, so first of all, there's a scale invariance, on at least on RD. So suppose now that we are on RD, then we can rescale solutions. So U lambda, I can define a solution U lambda of TNX, which is defined lambda as lambda to the 1/2 U of lambda squared T lambda X. Now, I can differentiate this function, then plug it into the equation, and then we see that this, for any let's say positive lambda, this defines another solution. Now, scaling, and this is if I compute now. Okay, if I take the grad of U lambda in L2, so at fixed time. And this is the same as grad of U at, now I have to be careful, as it should be lambda squared T. So which means that the space H1 is the scale invariant space, is the critical space. So okay, of course it's not quite true, because okay, it should be the homogeneous maybe, and also we are not on RD, right? We cannot really rescale. But now think of functions on the manifold as being very localized. Then locally things look somehow similar to RD. So for very concentrated functions, this might be a good heuristic. Okay, so it's quite in some sense scale invariant, and now this is now the reason why we call the initial value problem for the quintic NLS in three dimensions energy critical. Because the energy scales like H1, and H1 is almost scale invariant, so this is the energy equation. So the scaling heuristic suggests that local well positiveness of, let's say we are on RD, so local well positiveness for initial data in HS for big enough S, for S much bigger than the scale invariant exponent, should be easy to prove. If S is less than the scale invariant exponent, it should be impossible to prove. It fails. This is proved rigorously in many cases. And so in the critical case, it's, well, this is what we want to do, because in this is a particularly interesting case, because in this space, it's the local problem and the global problem, at least for small data, are equivalent. let me write one remark down, which I already mentioned. So it follows from one that local web processes with an existence time depending only on the norm implies global web hostedness. So in that sense, answer to question one implies two. Okay, now we will focus now on this problem. So 8 minutes, right? It's 1 hour.
Yes, including the questions.
I see. Okay, so all right then. Necessary ingredient for this for local web hostedness is that we have scale invariant estimates. Which help to the contraction estimate for the Duhamel term. Okay, so we will rewrite the Cauchy problem as an integral equation. So now I'm messing up the signs maybe, but I guess it's minus plus I integral 0 to t e to the I t minus tau delta e to the 4 times u. Okay, this is the variation of constants formula. And now what I mean so what we need is our estimates for these expressions, in particular for the nonlinear term, I need estimates which obey the scaling of the problem. And I think it's a good time to conclude with an example, and then we will do this, we will prove estimates of this type next time. So an example is, let's say, on the free sphere, there's the following estimate, which goes back to Birk, Girard, and Svetkov, which says that e to the i t delta phi in L6 of, let's say, a compact time interval, again 0, 1 times S3 is bounded by okay, and there's a certain loss. So I take again, functions which are frequency localized in the sense that their spherical harmonics expansion is restricted to degrees of dyadic size n. Oh, yes, of course, sorry. And then I can bound this mixed L6 norm in terms of some constant, I haven't finished it, and times the L2 norm of the initial data. And the correct power here is 2/3. Maybe this number is not too important. The important thing is that this is actually the correct number in terms of scaling. And now if you try to prove the local velpositiveness, it's easy to see that this is not enough. Because, so why did I write this down? Okay, so the L6 norm is somehow what you want, because now this is a quintic expression. And we will see later that by duality, we have to bound 5 functions times a dual function, 6 functions in L2, essentially. In L1. And now, so this you end up with an L6 norm on each function if you want, and if you apply Holder. But the problem now is that you lose derivatives on every single one, which, of course, does not prove that this is a map from a ball in some ball in H1 to itself. So we have to improve on that. And maybe this is a good time to stop for today. Highest frequencies we will have to make sure that we have an estimate on the two highest of the functions with the highest frequencies where there's no loss at all. Okay. Yes, we will prove next time we'll prove multilinear estimates, but they won't be 6 linear but trilinear. Other exponents, okay. Yeah, so, it becomes much more difficult. The problem becomes more difficult if the exponent is smaller. For higher exponents, there are results now. It can also be done. I mean, we will see next time why, really. So, and somehow the increasing the power helps. It makes the problem more accessible, but for example, for the cubic problem is much more difficult in this case. And it would be H1 half critical or so in 3 dimensions, and it's not clear to me how to do this. Oh. Okay, so in the two dimensions, there is no energy critical exponent, but then, so you're suggesting to look at the exponential one. I don't know. I guess some things can be done. Okay, so you would expect the time of existence somehow. I mean, okay, we can rescale it somehow. I mean, then we change, of course, for every fixed age, it's fine by some rescaling, but I guess now the time. Okay, so I don't know what to say. I mean, we don't have good long time control on these solutions. So the only thing we get from this argument in the end will be global by postness, just from this energy consideration. So now I'm not sure what to say. Okay, so first of all, on RD, there are many things known. So if the potential is, let's say, nice enough, then the dispersive estimate will still be true, and you get all Strichert's estimates. Then there are more complicated situations where there's some kind of trapping, and then things get more difficult. And, so here in this setup, somehow, if you add a potential here, well, as long, yeah, so it all depends on the spectrum of this linear operator. So this argument we will see later, it depends very, very much on this precise spectral information. So maybe. I would say it's the opposite, because what you do is on RD is really you rely on the dispersive estimate, and then things are quite easy. I mean, these problems are well understood since in more than 20 years now, because of the once you have the dispersive estimate, there's this general argument how to get Strichert's estimate, and once you have all the Strichert's estimates, you can easily close this contraction argument in Strichert's type spaces. Now, here the situation is worse in the sense that you don't have all the Strichert's estimates you would like to have. So in that sense, it's worse. And the proof in that it doesn't quite mimic what is done on RD.
Yeah, well, so it's always worse here, never better.
Yeah, that's I would. Yes.
Okay. Are there any more questions? I'll take the liberty of taking, despite what's written on the program, we'll take a little break.